Hi, Tor Lacey here with a lecture about Earth's destructive geologic forces, weathering, mass wasting, and erosion. The topography or shape of Earth's surface in any given place is a result of two opposing forces, constructive geologic processes versus destructive geologic processes. Constructive processes are driven by Earth's internal heat, which causes volcanic activity and mountain building along plate boundaries and hotspots. Destructive geologic processes act in opposition to constructive geologic processes because they break down and remove rock, shaping and lowering the landscape in the process. Most of these external processes operate on or near Earth's surface using energy from the sun and include weathering, mass wasting, and erosion. Weathering is the breakdown of bedrock into smaller pieces. In this photograph, we see the results of weathering on a house, car, and barrel, which have been around for 100 years or so. Imagine the effect weathering can have on bedrock, which has been exposed to the atmosphere for tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of years. There are two types of weathering, mechanical and chemical weathering. Mechanical weathering breaks down rock through physical processes. The most common agents of mechanical weathering include pressure expansion, frost wedging, root wedging, and salt expansion. Pieces of bedrock that form deep in Earth's crust, like granite, will crack up as they rise towards Earth's surface through uplift and erosion of the overlying rock. This happens because the rock is under progressively less pressure, which allows the body of rock to expand. Imagine how your sofa cushion responds as you remove the weight of your body. Rock does the same thing, but cracks itself up in the process since it is rigid and not spongy like your sofa cushion. Relatively thin fractures that form parallel to the surface of the body of bedrock lead to exfoliation, as we see here in the photograph. Exfoliation can in turn facilitate spheroidal weathering, which I will discuss later. Water plays an important role in the destruction of rock on or near Earth's surface. As you may know from personal experience, water expands when it freezes. Have you ever left a bottled beverage in the freezer too long? Here in the photograph, we have an ice cube tray with liquid water and with ice. The liquid water is taking up less space than is the ice. And again, this is because water freezes when it expands. Because of this unique property, water can do physical work on rock. When water from rain or melting snow freezes within cracks in a body of bedrock, it will expand and wedge the crack open, making it wider. This commonly happens in mountainous regions, where the temperature may fluctuate between above and below freezing many days of the year, allowing for many freeze-thaw cycles. Root wedging, like frost wedging, involves the wedging open of a pre-existing crack, but instead of water, plant roots penetrate cracks and expand the cracks slowly over time. Salt expansion is another form of mechanical weathering. In this case, salt dissolved in water or in the air can accumulate in cracks in rock, then precipitate out to form salt crystals. As the salt crystals grow, they wedge open cracks, making them wider. This unusual honeycomb appearance on the rock face here is a result of the salt expansion. Chemical weathering weakens rock through chemical reactions with the minerals contained in the rock. The reactions dissolve the minerals or change them into new minerals that are weaker than the original mineral. Take a look at some of the agents of chemical weathering. Dissolution happens when carbonic acid reacts with minerals in rock. Carbonic acid comes from acid rain, which forms in the atmosphere when carbon dioxide is dissolved in water or when water is acidified by organic matter in soil. When the acidic water comes into contact with soluble minerals, like the calcite in limestone, dissolution happens, dissolving the minerals and breaking down the rock. Acidic water is actually pretty common in nature and can react with silicate minerals like feldspars, converting them into clay through a process called hydrolysis. This results in changing hard and strong minerals like orthoclase, which might make up 30% of the mass of a body of granite, to a softer and weaker mineral like clay. Consequently, the framework of granite becomes weaker and it falls apart. As a body of silicate-rich rock, like granite, is uplifted towards Earth's surface, it can become fractured through pressure expansion and exfoliation. These fractures often occur as sets of parallel cracks called joints that intersect one another at nearly right angles, cutting up the body of granite into cubes. Acidic water from Earth's surface infiltrating the fractures chemically reacts with feldspars in the granite, causing them to change into clay through hydrolysis. These reactions are concentrated along the corners of the cubes. Think about what happens as you suck on an ice cube, causing the cubes to be weathered into spheres. This is spheroidal weathering. With more uplift and erosion, the sphered granite is exposed. Excellent examples of this can be found at Joshua Tree National Park, which is the closest national park to us here in Los Angeles. Another important chemical reaction that causes rock to become weaker and for it to break down is oxidation, also known as rusting. When iron-containing minerals are exposed to water, they can oxidize, creating oxidized minerals that may be weaker than the mineral they are replacing. In turn, the rock becomes weaker. Once rock has been weathered, it is susceptible to mass wasting and erosion. Erosion is the removal and transportation of weathered rock and sediment. Running water is the most common agent of erosion, but glacial ice, wind, and waves also can do erosion. Mass wasting is the downslope movement of weathered material, and like erosion, it is a process driven by gravity. Differential erosion describes the phenomenon that some types of rock or certain layers within a sequence of layered rock are more resistant to erosion than others. This is noteworthy because this results in different rates of erosion and the formation of distinct landforms, such as this butte in the photograph. Here, this top layer is more resistant to erosion than the layers beneath, and it has served to protect these underlying layers. So you end up with this landform sticking out prominently above the surrounding terrain. Mass wasting, also known by the more generic term landslides, can happen suddenly, without warning, or gradually over long periods of time. All mass wasting events move weathered material downhill under the influence of gravity. They are classified according to the type of material that is moving, which is either solid rock or weathered rock called regolith, and according to how that material moves, whether it falls, slides, or flows. This table shows the most common types of landslides, arranged by the type of movement and material that is moving. Falls, where rock free falls, rolls, or skips down a slope. Avalanche, which refers to an especially larger mass of rock that falls or disintegrates into smaller debris as it races downslope. Rotational slides, also known as slumps, involves loose rock called regolith and soil that slides down a curved rupture surface, causing the slide mass to rotate. In translational slides, material slides down a roughly flat surface. Flows are often triggered by prolonged heavy rainfall, which saturates soil and regolith, causing it to flow as a viscous, muddy mass, sometimes very quickly and with deadly consequences. For example, there was one debris flow in Venezuela that killed 30,000 people in a single event. In contrast, creep describes slopes that move imperceptibly slow. No one dies from creep, although a slowly moving slope can be very destructive to structures that have been built upon that slope. The terms in red that have been italicized are the specific names of the mass wasting events. So for falls, we have rock falls, avalanches, rock avalanches. For rotational slides, we'll call them slumps, whether they are made up of coarse or fine regolith and soil. For translational slides, if the material is rock, solid rock, we call it a rock slide or block slide. And if it's made up of coarse regolith and soil, it's a debris slide. Finer material, mudslide or lateral spread. Flows can be debris flows if the material is both muddy and coarse, or if it's all fine material, we call it an earth flow, and creep is simply creep. This illustration provides a visual summary of each type of mass wasting. Using these illustrations and the previous table, as well as your assigned reading, you will identify all the mass wasting events found at the document provided on the USGS Landslide Handbook. This assignment will be available on Canvas. So that's it for this lecture. Thank you for listening.